Hello, God's people. Get your spirit lifted through God's word from Harvester City, a place of insight, liberty, and standard, a place where hearts are uplifted and spirits soar. We believe God's word coming to you today will be a huge blessing to you, and your life will take a leap for the better. Stay blessed, stay positive, and always keep your spirit high. God bless you.
Significance. So every voice is significant, and even the wicked voices or the voices of the adversary, significant. Voice of reason, significant. So no voice is useless. We mentioned last time that even on TV, all the breaking news try to convey a particular message, you know. So every time if you listen to only breaking news on TV, and it forms the basis of what you want to believe. Sometimes you may not hear all the good news all the time. But if you listen to the word of God as your breaking news, as I said last week, the word of God has a way of speaking to you, speaking to your spirit man, and it's able to, you know, make you walk by faith. I wonder what people will be able to achieve in this season without the help of God. I was talking with my daughter when we were driving to church. I said, what can people really do without God's grace? Is it in the world of today, war everywhere, uncertainty everywhere? That is why I need to pay closer attention. Somebody say closer attention to the things I have heard before. You know, the Bible said that in King James, said you should give a more earnest heed to the things which you have heard before, lest at any time you will let them slip away. So paying attention does not prevent them from slipping away. It keeps them in your memory bank. It keeps them in your spirit man. So some of the things I preach today, if I don't meditate on the word of God or sometimes study, I may forget them. Nobody has a brain that will keep something for 20 years. No. You have to keep studying, keep renewing your mind. That's the only way you can keep these things in your spirit man, keep regurgitating that which has entered. The Bible said that the Holy Ghost is meant to, you know, bring us to the knowledge of the truth and also put us in remembrance. So one of the, you know, effect of the presence of the Holy Spirit is that he will put you to remembrance of the things you have read, the things you have understood in the past, the things you've been taught in the past. So the Bible said that which we have heard, lest at any time we should let them sleep. That's two. And it says, for if the message given through angels, the law spoken by them to Moses, if the message given through angels, the law spoken by Moses was given through angels, was authentic and proved sure, the law was very sure, and every violation and disobedience received an appropriate, just and adequate penalty. Now look at verse 3. Look at verse 3. But how shall we escape appropriate retribution if we neglect and refuse to pay attention to such a great salvation? The word of God is such a great salvation. Amen? As it now offered to us, letting it drift past us forever. For it was declared at first by the Lord himself. It was declared at first by the Lord himself. It was confirmed to us and proved to be real and genuine by those who what? Personally heard him. So the word of God has not changed. It was declared by the Lord at first and confirmed to us by those who heard him. Now look at verse 4. You know, look at verse 4. Besides this evidence, it was also established and plainly endorsed by God, who showed what? His approval of it by signs and what? Wonders and various miraculous manifestations of his power, and by impacting the gifts of the what? Holy Spirit to the believers according to his what? Own will. So the Bible was first spoken, or the word of God was spoken by the Lord, you know, confirmed to us by those who heard him. And the Bible said that this is authentic. Over time, the word stands strong. So anytime we study the Bible, we begin to see what God has spoken in over thousands and thousands of years. The same voice that, you know, brought creation into being, the same voice that is speaking to us today. And if creation has not failed, you know, what God has said concerning you will not fail. That's why the Bible says that it is easier for what? Heaven and earth to do what? Pass away. Than for any what? Any small tittle of the law to fail. So the Bible cannot fail. As long as the word of God created heaven and earth, and we are still standing on heaven and earth today, and heaven has not failed, it means that whatever God has said to you can never fail. If God has told you that by his stripes you are healed, it cannot fail. If God has said that you are the head and not the tail, it cannot fail. As long as earthquake, or as long as the ground you are standing on has not moved. Amen? Jesus was about to be crucified. And Barnabas too. was about to be crucified, what did the people say? When Pilate asked them, what did the people say? They said, give us Barabbas. But crucify Jesus, isn't that so? The voice of all the opposition. They will never say any good thing about you. Just, do you think we should promote this man? Don't promote him. See, don't promote him. You'd rather promote the other person. And you don't know what goes on in the boardroom. This is why you should pray. Because sometimes it's not as if they don't want to promote you, but somebody is speaking against you because the person does not like you. Amen? Your boss has already promised you that they are going to promote you, and all of a sudden you find out that your name is not there. Because at the higher level, somebody who does not like you has recommended that your name be removed. Now your boss does not know until it's been approved. And when you complain, they say, don't worry, next time they'll promote. Next time will come, the same thing will happen. Your boss will say, I'm tired of this. I don't even know what to say again. I'm tired. That is why you need to pray, because the heart of kings are in the hands of God. So even people that determine promotion, God has them in his hands. Amen?
Amen.
Keep speaking in advance, because some of the things that concern you are determined by others. If government does wrong policy, sometimes it affects everybody. That's why you need to speak to your life and say, I'm favored. When there's a casting out, there's a lifting up for me. I don't operate in a normal economy. My economy is from glory. Amen?
Amen?
It looks foolish. But if you're not foolish, you're not acting by faith. Faith is foolish. See faith? Why are you doing this thing? I mean, it's as if this man is mad. People have not called you names. You're not working by faith. If everybody agrees what you're doing, it's not faith. Faith sometimes is obscure. Faith sometimes is mannerless. Faith sometimes is not celebrated. That's why sometimes when you act by faith, don't confer with flesh and blood. Because they will disagree with you, they will talk you out of it. Do you believe what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
So one opposing voice. Then the other one is the voice of dissent. That's also the voice of dissent. That came from John the Baptist in Matthew chapter 11, verse 3. The Bible said that John the Baptist questioned Jesus Christ, said, are you the come or should we wait for who? Another. After discouragement. You can imagine people you poured your life into. Somebody you've celebrated. All of a sudden, there are many people like that in churches too. You find out people that you've even blessed. By the time they speak of you now, they start saying things about you. Never you judge somebody based on what somebody told you about the person until you have an encounter with the person. It's only a foolish person that will make judgment based on what somebody told you about somebody else. And meanwhile, you've not encountered the person say, you are the person, you have good rapport. Somebody just come and tell you this person because of a thing that happened between both of them, and then all of a sudden you form your opinion. And when you see the person, it's that. That is not wisdom. Amen? Because the person may not even tell you what they have done to warrant that kind of treatment. It may be that the other person you are listening to is somebody who is a talkative, but the other person that is being talked about is not a talkative, so you may not even know from the person what happened. Sometimes seek to hear the other side of the story. Amen? I've seen couples that just come and complain, not in this church, even overseas, complain and complain about their spouses, but by the time you hear the other story, you'll be tired. Because things are not often the way they appear to be. Are you following what I'm saying? So don't ever make judgments based on what somebody tells you. People have ulterior motives. People can, decide to cook up stories, rumor mongering. Don't use the social media to judge people. There are a lot of people being talked about, men of God being talked about on social media, are pretty nice people if you meet them face to face. But people think that defamation of character is what can lift you up. When you spoil somebody else's name, there's a payback time. Your name will also be, put on the slab to be spoiled. So let's be careful about what we say about other people and what we hear other people say about them. Praise the Lord. Something came to my mind while we were praying. The Lord spoke to me. He said, listen, if you're in a church, anything that the pastor says or there's a policy trust for the church, at your group level, somebody else begins to speak. This time we're praying, God just, that thing came to my mind. I'll say it on Sunday service too. Somebody, because you're a head of department, begins to go at daggers drawn with what is being preached. Beware. Are you following what I'm saying? Because when judgment comes, it hits everybody. You just have to beware and withdraw yourself. Or better say, challenge the person and say, no, this is not what pastor said. Or this is not what the church said. What is not what we discussed in the workers' meeting. Are you following what I'm saying? Any person that works at cost purposes with what is being preached on the altar is a Judas in disguise. Even if you're a group leader. Every group is meant to align to the church purpose. Praise the Lord. Hello? Every department is meant to align to the... Once a department begins to work contrary to what the church stands for, it's a dissident group. In a church, there's something like the house of David, the house of Saul. Do you hear me? It is one body. One body. So if a particular group or department is doing things contrary to what the church stands for, please call the person, whatever leadership, call the person to order. You have a right to do so. Or better still, if the person does not change, tell the pastor. Amen? That thing hit me well, because you can never know why people are hindered at their level. It may not be that somebody who is there, who does not like, you know, what the man of God stands for, may just be saying things contrary to what the man of God says and what people ought to do. Many of the things I tell people to do here, people who do them, their testimonies are mind-boggling. I'm telling you, many of people I give instructions. There are people I call, I give personal instructions, and they do it. And once they do it, bam, I may just tell you, go and do this. Go and do this. Go and buy this thing and give it. And they do it. Bam, you see that their life, boom, changes. Say, pastor, what I've seen this video, I've never seen it in my life. Why? Because some things come by instructions. And if we give instructions generally, it may not even come personally to you, but generally from the altar, it is your duty to receive it and run with it. Any department that goes contrary to the objective of a church is working as a dissident group. And God is not going to honor that. Praise the name of the Lord. And that's why you find out some departments, people's progress are impeded. Why? Because you find out that even all the things that we see flowing from the head is not flowing to them. Why? Because people have their own mindset. And they are operating a different agenda from the agenda of the church. But if you see a group that runs at, you know, in the same way with the policy trust of the church, they get blessed. Because God is not an author of confusion. God does not make mistakes. Amen? The oil will flow from the head down to the what? Beard to the what? Skirts of the garment. That's the way it flows. It does not flow from the waist. Oil does not flow from the chest. Amen? It flows from the what? Head. Down to the discussion. I don't know why I'm saying that, but I have to say it. And let me drop it here. So that means whatever we say here too is a voice. It's a voice because God knows what message to give. I've preached a message on the seven churches in the book of Revelation. I thought that God gave every angel a peculiar message for their particular church. So when a word comes here and you receive the word and run with it, you are indirectly positioning yourself for the anointing, because sometimes we spend time in the presence of the Lord. Sometimes we spend time in prayer. And once we send that in prayer, God gives us a message for the church. It's the duty of the church people to now, that's why I talked about, you know, posture the other day. You know, you take the same posture that the man of God has taken in prayer. Take the same posture and receive the word and begin to run with it. Because everything God will ever do with us will come through voices. Somebody say voices. God is going to speak. What else is God going to do? Do I come here and start interpreting my dream to you? No. It's the word. And it has to come through voices. So anytime I stand and I speak to you, it's your duty to receive what I have spoken and begin to run with it. Now, if you run with it, it's going to bless you. It's going to be beneficial to you, because I'm not speaking of my own accord. I'm speaking based on the prompting of the Spirit. I'm telling you the truth. Anything I say here is not by flesh. I don't have anything to gain by speaking by flesh. I can't manipulate anybody. It's impossible. I don't do anything to draw any attention to myself. No. What I do is, as I hear God, I speak. As I hear God, I speak. And you see, the earlier you receive it, or maybe you go and somebody begins to tell you something contrary to what the pastor has preached, be wary. Or you watch the person's life and see whether this person is the perfect example. Sometimes the number of years somebody's in church does not determine the person is an authentic voice to listen to. Praise the Lord. Some people you need to listen to are people who are obedient. People who are towing the line of the ministry. Who walk in the same trajectory with the pastor. Any person who is divisive, listen to the person you're in trouble. The Bible says, mark them that cause divisions, contrary to the doctrine which you have received, and avoid them. Yes, sir. Mark them that cause. You mark them that cause divisions based on contrary to the doctrine. So the doctrine we preach here, you know, is meant for the church, not another doctrine. So if you see those who cause divisions based on the doctrine which you have received, try and avoid them. Every church that thrives prospers based on the voice that they hear from the altar. Praise the Lord. The message. Likewise, anybody I invite to stay here, the person says things that are contrary to the message that God has given us, the person will not come back again. Why? Because words are very important. And the things we teach are very important. Even if I invite you, you know, or even a member of this church, and I give you the altar to minister, and you say things that are contrary to the direction of the ministry, you won't preach. Amen? You will not. Why? Because, you see, words are important, and the things we say, it's not your personal opinion, it's based. Do you know sometimes when we're invited to preach, you ask the man of God, what message do you have me to preach? Praise the Lord. Because it is not what I want. You can say things that, you know, and you have to be careful. You have to be careful because you can say one thing, bam, church, don't scatter. So don't say you are bold. You are not bold anything. By the time you come that bold, go and do your own pulpit and become bold. No, that person's pulpit. They just call you and say, because there's a direction the church is moving. So when the church begins to move in that direction, somebody else comes and says one thing, it begins to unsettle matters. Why? Because voices are very powerful and voices are very significant. So any voice that comes here and stands and speaks contrary to what a man of God stands for. It's a dissident voice. That's why you align the voice. No matter how experienced you are, no matter how good a preacher you are, you won't come again. You won't preach. And many churches are like that. Many churches are, you cannot say things. As a matter of fact, you must listen to the voice of the Spirit that come into a ministry. Don't say because you are bold. And, you know, I'm bold. I'm a prophet. You prophesy in your room. Praise the Lord. At the end of the day, you cut yourself off and begin to prophesy in your room because nobody's going to let you come to the altar. I'm going to prophesy things contrary to the direction the ministry is headed. Praise the Lord. Are you getting what I'm saying? So please, that's by the side. So you have the voice of dissent, and that was the voice used by John the Baptist when he said in Matthew chapter 11, verse 3, that Jesus Christ, you know, then you have the resenting voice, the voice that resents. You know, a resentful voice is a voice that speaks contrary, amen, at cross purposes. You know, like the voice of Judas, when that woman brought the perfume to go pour on Jesus. I think John chapter 12 from verse 4 to 6, the woman, you know, brought that perfume to pour, a special perfume, Judas said no, she should have sold that thing and given to the what? To the poor. Somebody said she have sold it and given to the poor. And it was as if Judas loved the poor. No, Judas did not love the poor. The Bible also said that Judas was saying it because he had you know, eye for the offering. No, not because he loved the poor. Amen. Amen. You know, so another one I'm going to talk about today is the unrelenting voice. Somebody say unrelenting voice. Unrelenting voice is very important for us as Christians. Unrelenting means never giving up. You are not giving up. Amen. No movements, everybody sit down. Somebody say unrelenting voice. It's a voice that never gives up. You will need the unrelenting voice as Christians. That's the voice of somebody who never says never. I'm not going to give up. The importunate woman had an unrelenting voice. Mark chapter 7, 24 to 30 talks about the Syrophoenician woman. She had, you know, an unrelenting voice. She was called a dog indirectly. And she refused to go away. Many people will leave church if you call them any slightest name. Amen?
Amen.
They will leave church. You won't even call them a dog. Because you caution them, they will leave church. But that woman stood her ground and got her miracle. Sometimes miracles come when you are tested. Tested and tested beyond your wit's end. You had gotten to your wit's end, but somehow you held back. I'm telling you, certain things that will come your way, you would have given up. So that when it comes, amen?
Amen.
That's the country I applied for a visa the other time. No, they didn't reply me. I'd done everything, reply me. I just said, why would this country do this? I was supposed to send me a mail to bring my passport for my visa. They didn't. I kept quiet. Somebody told me I should write them a mail. Give me the email. I wrote them a mail while I was in the U.S. Why won't you people reply me? Nobody told me anything. I forgot about it. So when I came back to Nigeria, they wrote me a mail. I said I should bring my passport for my visa. That thing I waited for. Praise the Lord. Just came. Now that I even got it, and the visa they gave me was about 8 years. Now listen, what I'm saying this is that, you see, when that thing came, the excitement had waned.
Yes.
I'm not even in a hurry again. Are you following what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
I'm not in a hurry. Why? Because some things that happen to us just takes away the excitement so that even when that Lamborghini comes, you're not excited. Other car you love, you are believing God for. By the time you drive it for 1 week, you're tired. I wish I would have. You are tired. No condition is permanent. No condition is permanent. By the time you receive all those things you think you have, and I wish this house, I wish I was living in this estate. By the time you leave it, bam. And I think that's where God wants to get us to, so that we don't get too excited. By the time you have all those visas, and you won't be, it will not, you'll be afraid of, you'll be tired of, not afraid, you'll be tired of flying. Flying again. But people are getting that, I want to fly. Oh my, what is your hobby? My hobby is traveling. Of course, you never travel. By the time you start traveling, oh, what is your boredom? Traveling. You'll be tired. And God gets us to that stage so that nothing can really move you. You've gotten to that stage where nothing moves you. When you look around you, what is it? If you can even, in fact, if you have the money to afford this, is it car? Is it to fly first class? Is it to fly business class? Vanity. Is it to wear this cloth? Anyone you can afford, you can wear it. Vanity. Everything is vanity. I am telling you, that's why Solomon came to a point, he said, the conclusion of the whole matter is what? Serve God and do what? His commandments. And that is the whole duty of man. But he has seen it all. He had the women, he had the concubines, everything. He had the riches. Everything is vanity. How long is saying that this visa, I need visa, I want to go for where? When it comes. You've been there, seen it, moved around. I've even traveled to most cities in the U.S., more than people that live there. I'm telling you. At least no time I travel, I don't go up to five cities preaching. So it's no big deal. You do all those things and you find out that when you stay even for a time, you find out that it's no big deal even. People are saying, now I want to jackpot. By the time you jackpot, your eye will open. You want to lotter. From jackpot to lotter. You want to lotter. People over there want to lotter. You say we want to jackpot. Think is the best thing that can happen to me is to jackpot. Because all the things you see on the TV, on the movies, Netflix is all film. The reality is that even when you go there, you may not have time for Netflix. Amen?
Amen.
Kitty kata kitty. You work on Sunday. That favorite service you like going to, you won't even work on service day. I need the money. When the money comes, you make it and you change it to naira money. But you see, by the time it hits your account, your bills are going. Most of the things you pay, accommodation, two-room apartment, $1,900 every month. Not every year. $2,000. Some places. Two-bedroom. That's in a year, $24,000. So how much are you earning? You buy, you pay car note, your favorite car, that one you are dreaming of. What's the name of that Toyota you are dreaming of? Is it Highlander? You buy it, you drive Highlander. By the time you come, the money hits your account, boom, every end of month. Baba Agba is having about $400 in the account. Haven't you seen people that went to UK that are complaining? By the time expenses go on, what they have in their whole account for the whole month is $90. £90. Amen? He said, it's better for me. Even in London now, you can't see accommodation except in the rural areas. Did they tell you that side of the story? What they tell you is, meanwhile, every day, your own is complaining. What they are doing by those pictures is that where there's a car sit down, there's a lifting up. Later you see them, that's their own lifting up. You are busy complaining. Casting down with the casting down by the speech, the statements you make with your mouth. It's not the way you think it is. I am telling you, I've been around, you know. Except for some people, even at that, in a tire. Very boring. All these things will hang around and this is freedom. It's difficult because on Sunday that is one of that, when you have a big church, people tell you they're clocking that they're going to work. What are you going to do? Somebody can call you. Somebody in the center can tell you, ah, they put me on duty this morning. No, please, I won't be around. What are you going to do? We tell them, ah, the Lord says you should be here today. Are you going to pay their bill? You can't pay their bill, amen? No, you just tell them, oh, really? Oh, I'm sorry. So you keep, anything God does not give you, don't struggle for it. Just wait for God's time. Amen? Wait, God knows what he's doing. You may think you can handle it. You can't. That's why it appears that a lot of people are busy. They don't have time. No, because, I mean, it's a life that is round the clock. Yeah, you even have driver. You have people that run errands for you. You have people that live with you that help you out. You have gardeners. You have security. There, everything is do-it-yourself. Whether you have waist pain or not, do it yourself. Praise the name of the Lord. Somebody said there are many voices and unrelenting voices. That woman in Mark chapter 7, she said in verse 24. I'll read from verse 24. Mark 7 and verse 24. And from thence she arose and went into the borders of what? Tyre and Sidon, and entered into an house, and would have no man know it, for it could not be hid. Verse 25. For a certain woman whose young daughter had an unclean spirit heard of him, and came and fell at his feet. Verse 26. For the woman was a Greek, a Syrophoenician by nation, and she besought him. The word besought there means to like garage him, and that he would cast forth the devil out of her daughter. Verse 27. And Jesus Christ was already trying to hide. So you can understand the condition he was in today. He wasn't willing to just mingle with everybody. He wasn't willing to entertain any guest. So he was really, really, you know, already pissed that the woman was there. That's, let me just put it like that. And just said unto her, let the children first be filled. Amen? For it is not meet to take what? The children's bread and what? Cast it onto the dogs. In other words, if this can make her go away, let me just rest. I want to hide. Look at verse 29. And she answered and said unto him, yes, Lord, yet the dogs under the table eat of the children's crumbs. Verse 29. And he said unto her, for this saying, go thy way, thy devil is gone out of your what? Daughter. Verse 30. And when she was come to her house, she found out the devil had gone out of her daughter. Why? The woman stood her ground. It's not everybody that can take that kind of nonsense. And I told you that one thing about dogs, I preached that message here, is that dogs have staying power. We have a small dog at home, we call him Pumpkin. Pumpkin, even if you chase him away today, if you come, as we hunt, we press the horn to our gate and go in there, Pumpkin will rush and jump as if he has not seen us for 1 week. And be jumping on everybody. Is this the children will be telling, please don't jump on me. You're using your nails to. But the dog is excited. Why am I saying that? Dogs don't bear grudge. Even if you beat them, as you come back, they're forgotten they beat it. They have a staying power. So that woman was deterred when Jesus Christ said, what is meant for the children is not meant for the dogs. And the woman said, even the dogs eat of the what? Bread. You can chase a dog away. Once you finish eating and the dogs come there, it will start sniffing on the ground. Whether there's a little bit that fell on the ground. Why? Because they keep coming back. They have a staying power. Somebody says staying power. They eat of that which falls from the master's table. And that is unrelenting. The woman is unrelenting. Sometimes we need to be unrelenting to be able to push through by faith. Faith is unrelenting. Faith does not give up. Amen? Many of you here are around every Tuesday, Sunday because of the faith you have in God. And let me tell you, God will never forsake you. The time your season will come, people will think you did something. That's how it happens. When your season comes, it will be as if you visited somewhere. You don't understand what you are doing. It's faith. This is what I call faith. Faith is not that I believe in. No. A lot of people share their testimony. By the time your own comes, it will be brand new. Their own will be obsolete. Amen. You are celebrating their car. When your car comes, their own will be old model. Amen. That is how this thing happens. When your house comes, your house will be new model. Amen. Many things God is preparing for you is because it's time it will happen, you will be the talk of the town. Your miracle will be brand new. It will be like the miracle of the season. It will be like the testimony of the season. So when there are delays, just wait. Your time is coming. Hallelujah. Somebody say, unrelenting voice. Somebody say unrelenting voice. The next one I'll talk about is accepting voice. Accepting. Now, that accepting voice is Luke 22, I think at verse 42. While Jesus Christ was in the Garden of Gethsemane, the Bible said that he was weary. You know, he was weary. Go back a bit, like when he went to that garden. Let me just read that story a bit so that you see that Jesus Christ also felt anguish. He felt pain. He was distressed. And he prayed in his distress. You know, maybe you go to verse 39. And he came out and went as he was wont to the Mount of Olives. And his disciples also followed him. Verse 40. And when he was at the place, he said unto them, pray that you enter not into what? Pray that you enter not into. I'm sure why he said that to them was because he himself was already undergoing a kind of temptation. And he was withdrawn from them, about the stones cast, and knelt down and prayed. He knelt down and prayed. He withdrew from them. Probably he didn't want them to hear him cry. He was in anguish. Sometimes when a leader is going through some things, who does he even cry to? Because he's used to encouraging others. Who would encourage him? So he withdrew himself and went to to cry. Let his tear just flow. Has it happened to you before? You encourage your young ones, but at the end of the day, when they drop the phone, after encouraging them, you start crying because of what they told you. Amen? Amen. You start crying. You start wailing. You start pitying your parents, pitying your siblings. Look at your parents that used to be very active. All of a sudden, old age is making them look so old and frail. Amen? Amen. I'm saying, Father, if thou be willing, remove this cup from me. Jesus Christ went through things. There's a particular, this story in I think in the book of Matthew. Matthew's account said that he was so distressed that he prayed and his sweat became like great drops of blood. I think Matthew 24, something like that. But let's stay here. Father, if thou be willing, remove this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but what? Let thy will be what? That's an accepting voice. He has accepted the will of God. Father, I accept your will. Let your will be done. What will I even do? You know, when you wait on something too long and it's not coming forth, just accept and say, Father, let your will be what? That's the voice of acceptance. That's the voice a Christian should have. Sometimes when you want to submit to the will of God, just relax and say, Father, let your will be done. I'm not gonna struggle for this thing for too long. There are things I have prayed for. And then it wasn't forthcoming because it was not the time to bring them to pass. And when you realize that timing is important, three things that will determine what God will do in your life. You know, what is the reason? What is the season? Amen? We need encouraging voices. I've told you that at my stage now in life, I don't just do things for the sake of doing them. If I'm going to bring you into my space, you must be some kind of encouragement. Praise the Lord. That's not only keeping friends for the sake of keeping friends. Why? These are my friends. No. And their friends are not bringing any encouragement. No, nothing. They don't add any value to your life. It's just because they are classmates does not mean they are your friends. Yes, sir. We went to the same school. That's okay. We have a school forum, FGC forum. Understand? Before I even know it, the message I've gone to 1,000. It's just because my bad day was there. I had to open it and they were wishing me bad. I had to just go and click and say, thank you very much for the bad day wishes. Next time I go there, it may be under 1 month. That thing multiplies like, I don't even know how those guys have time. Because people from all over the world are there. So people from different time zones. So when you are sleeping, some people are chatting. By the time you wake up, you see their own and start replying. By the time you reply, they are sleeping. So it's like a merry-go-round. 24/7, it is very busy. Man, I don't have that kind of time. Amen? Amen. There are many things they add me to. Even family own, I don't have time because it's not everything except for my immediate family, praise God. It's not everything you have time for. I'm going to say, Apostle, it's good that you go into TikTok. TikTok will help. Which time do I have? Even Instagram, but I don't even have time. The only thing I have time for Instagram is when they post my this one. That's the only thing I see. If you tell me all the stories on Instagram, I don't know. In fact, people send me things on WhatsApp. By the time I click it, it wants to go to TikTok. It can't go because I can't even remember my password on TikTok. Which time do I have? No time. Amen? Absolutely no time. There are people that wake up in the morning, TikTok is where they do their quiet time. Because TikTok has this algorithm thing. So once you click on one thing, you'll be showing the same kind of message. Before you know it, that thing can be addictive. No time. Even these days, I don't even have, my children don't even watch TV again. I say, this thing we'll pay for. It's only football I watch. I'm an Arsenal fan and I love, in fact, when Premiership opened, I was happy. Because anytime on Saturdays, I watch my team, and Sunday after service, that's a good way to relax. Amen? That's a habit to form. But my children don't even want to, I say, this year, CV, nobody, what? They don't have time. Maybe unless it's Netflix. But if I go home now, I can watch CNN, watch Arise, amen? And channels intermittently, nothing. Because as you get advanced in life, you begin to thin down your options. There are things you won't have time for. You won't have time for drama, amen? So many drama, friends, you don't have time for it. You begin to focus. Sometimes I go to bed early, wake up 3 a.m. every day. Because my time starts by 3 a.m. So at least sometimes I sleep by 10. 4 hours sleep sometimes. Wake up by 2 something, 3, I'm exercising. 3, past 3, I start praying and all that. And after I pray finish, I'll sleep a little bit. Morning again, I begin to pray again. Stand up, I'm out. What time do you have for frivolities? No time. You find out that even your friends begin to reduce. Amen? You find out that you only keep friends that are in the same line of destiny with you. You don't have time for nonsense. Praise the Lord. People that have many, many friends, they are still coming up. By the time, my mother used to tell me this when I was young. This is my friend. By the time you start getting to our age, you find out that all these people, you won't see many of them. And it's true. Because it's only those you align with in destiny. Even in ministry, not everybody can be your friend. Because most times we spend time in the presence of God. Amen? Amen. We spend time in the presence of God. A friend of mine came the other day to my house and said, man, Pastor, you know, friend and I, we don't even know anybody again. A lot of our friends, a lot of people we know have that bad. A lot of people who know everybody's busy. People don't have time, you know, like the way we used to have time those days and meet. I say it's true. Because we spend more time now doing the things that help our vision. We spend more energy on the things pertaining to our vision and not on frivolities. Somebody say encouraging voice. If you look at First Kings, I think chapter 30, verse 6. First Kings 30 and verse 6. The Bible talks about, you know, David, the Bible said that David did what? David encouraged himself in the Lord, his God. I saw that his God, very important. First Kings 30 and verse 6. David encouraged himself in the Lord, his God. We all need encouraging voices. That's why I told you on Sunday, pick up a phone, call somebody. Not just Sunday, do it this week. Anybody you remember you've not heard from, ask them how they are doing. Amen? Amen? Ask them how they are doing. And, you know, just let them know that you just want to check up on them. Simple. Very, very important. Because these are trying times for a lot of people. So if you look at that First Samuel, the Bible says that, you know, David got to a point where he was distressed, but he had to encourage himself in the Lord is God. I saw that he's God. Very important. He called himself in the Lord. He called him in the Lord he knows. That is his God. In the Lord, his God. So he began to look at the things that made God his God. Amen? Amen? And began to look at them and use those things to encourage himself.
Thank you for watching today's broadcast. If you were blessed by the message and you would like us to pray with you, or you want to give your life to Jesus Christ, feel free to write to us via email. harvesterscity@gmail.com, and we will respond immediately. This message was brought to you by Harvester City. God bless you, real good.
So let the church
say.